Absolutely stunning.
On these kinds of trips, what I like to do is take a few different modes of transport, see how everyone gets around. So far I've had international flight, a bus, a taxi, boat across the Nile. What we've not had is one of these bad boys. That is until now. We're off, boys. So just in case you wondered how one of these gets pumped up, well, surprisingly, what you do is you blow loads of air into it and then make it hot by using a big flame. I don't know what more there is to tell you. And then it takes care of itself, puts itself upright, jump in it, off we go. Right, so I'm currently being toasted alive. I think this is it. I think we're going. We're definitely going. Bloody hell, we are off. Look at the view from up here. I'm not going to make this too history-ish, we're not going to be going in and around these places, but from this viewpoint we can see the Ramesseum, the Ramses II temple. You can also see the Valley of the Kings, the Valley of the Queens, the Valley of the Nobles, basically all these places where a lot of really, really important people are buried. Valley of the Kings has more than 60 pharaohs buried in it. They're still actually digging new ones up. There's still two more they're currently excavating, and they're going to be excavating this area for a very long time because there's just so much stuff to find. Temple of the Nobles is loads of people like tax collectors or assistants to pharaohs and kings in the past. There's more than 500 of them buried just there in the Valley of the Nobles. Gotta say, it feels pretty mad hanging over the edge of a hot air balloon. 600 meters up. Not a bad view from up here. One of the best And I think this is what a crash landing looks like, boys. Mildly concerned about this. Bossman just told me he's gonna try and show off and fly, touching the top of this sugar cane. Not sure about this. Help. Only the top. Be careful, start. All right, we're alive. We're going back up again. Such an incredible mix of things from up here. You've got the River Nile, the longest river in the world, just over 4,000 miles long, but everyone knows that. And then you've got the green stuff, loads of agriculture, and then immediately into desert. It's such an interesting mix. It's because of all this extremely important stuff that you can see from this balloon that I think makes it probably the best place in the world to actually take a hot air balloon. Given all of the ancient things you can see, and not only that, but as we can see, the view is absolutely outstanding. But on top of that, it's also the cheapest. So normally you're paying at least 200 quid for a go in a hot air balloon, places like Turkey and wherever else. Here, it cost me 30 quid this morning to go on this one, 30 quid. And now on our way down, and then this group of blokes, they pad down the balloon, pack it all away and everything. We get off and that, boys, is about that. What a way to start a Monday morning. Luxor is a beautiful city, and I've got to say, I've quite enjoyed my time here, but we must continue. This morning we've taken minibus and a hot air balloon. Let's go and have a look at what the Egyptian train system's like. Head a few hundred miles more south to Aswan. Chaos, as I suspected. What was interesting about that was when the train was getting to Aswan, the guy just turned all the seats around so you'd have to turn the train around. Genius. And we have touched down in Aswan, which is famous. Well, you can probably see behind me, for its quarries, and for one thing in particular that we're about to go up here and have a look at. All of this is granite, and granite is a really good stone to make enormous single piece structures called obelisks out of. We've seen a couple of them in Luxor Temple and in Karnak Temple the past couple of days, and there is one very special one here, still here. This enormous lump is the unfinished obelisk. This is, or was intended to be, the largest obelisk ever built. It was ordered by Queen Hatshepsut, someone who we'll talk about in a minute and who doesn't get enough credit. And this was going to be 140 feet tall and weighing more than 1,000 tons. I think it's nearly 1,200 tons. 1 billion grams. But then famously, it cracked halfway through being built. Someone got their P45 for that one, and the obelisk was left here and never used. Been here for nearly 4,000 years. So this was going to be the top, all the way 140 feet in that direction. But then, cracked, wounded. And if we wander around to another obelisk, it's not as big or as famous as this one, but it's important as well. We can have a look at how they built it, and that is what is really vital about this site, because it finally showed us how on earth they managed to put together these enormous blocks of stone. Imagine how the chap felt who did that. It takes years to cut one of those things out of those ridiculous stones. Years. Someone just puts too many beans behind it, whacks it a bit hard, game over. After all that, you'd be fuming, wouldn't you? You would be fuming. And then, as we climb down to Obelisk 2, as it's called, we can see exactly how they would have made these. So, look at the size of it, right? This is an obelisk in work in progress, because all the way back there. This one's not as massive, but you know, it's still a pretty big one. So you can see how they would have done it. So they would have, that would have been the ground level at the top of it. They would have dug down using these rocks, literally whacking their way through to get all the way down. Then when they get down, they go and do some whacking inwards until it's like this. And then, well, nobody really knows what they did with them then. Obviously people can speculate and say, well, probably put them on a boat somewhere, or rolled them on logs or whatever we think they did with the pyramid stones, but they're pretty big pieces of kit. It's pretty hard to say for definite how you would actually move something of this size manually. So old bird Hatshepsut, actually she was quite a young bird. She was 12 when she married her half brother. This isn't starting very well, is it? So she was the daughter of a pharaoh called Thutmose I. His son, Thutmose II, married her when she was 12. Interesting. Anyway, they had a kid called Thutmose III. This is all getting a little bit conspicuous. And then when Thutmose II died, her husband, and Thutmose III was too young to be in charge, Hatshepsut became the first ever woman in charge of Egypt. There were in fact only three ever in 3,000 years of ancient Egypt, only ever three women in charge. And the one that gets all the credit, Cleopatra, didn't come until 1,200 years after Hatshepsut. And yeah, being the first one ever does make her a pretty big deal, but she's also responsible for a lot of the cool stuff we saw in Luxor, in the Temple of Luxor and in Karnak Temple. Here we have big Coptic Orthodox Cathedral of the Archangel Michael. There's not an awful lot I know about it, apart from it was built 10 years ago, and the fact that the services are also given in Arabic in a Christian place. And it's also pretty cool that the fact that it's only 10 years old means they are still bothering to build Christian stuff in a country that is predominantly Muslim. Get your eyes on this view over the Nile. I don't know about you lot, but I was kind of expecting, after thousands of years of just constant use, that the Nile was going to be all a bit brown and minging. And it's absolutely stunning. Another cool thing we can see from here is the old Cataract Hotel, this big orangey thing to my left. This is famously where Agatha Christie stayed for a year in 1937 to write her book Death on the Nile. And that is something actually relevant because that film is currently in the cinema. In there is also a restaurant called the 1902 Restaurant. That was opened and inaugurated and everything by Winston Churchill. How about that? However, I am not going to pay the 45 billion quid to stay there for the night, so we're not going to go in. But it's there and it looks pretty cool. This is such a peaceful place, this garden. Just hopped on a ferry to get to an island in the Nile. This one's called Elephantine Island. This is a 400 by 1200 metre little strip in the middle of the Nile that we could see from the east bank. This is right in the middle, and as we can see, it's very quiet, very traditional. and has some cool wall paintings by the look of it. This is more of a Nubian settlement as opposed to Egyptian. Nubia being the bit of land that kind of went anywhere further south than this historically. And just like that, we've reached the other side of the island. It's just so quiet. The Nubians, for reference, lived and still live in southern modern day Egypt, so a bit further south, a bit of a hot climate, etc. They have their own language and still speak it. And there's a couple of Nubian settlements in and around Aswan, this being one of them. Honestly, it feels like I'm in a completely different country. It feels really tropical. It descends into a series of twisty alleyways. There's a lot of colour about on the walls. The traditionally Nubian people built all the houses out of coloured clay. And the name itself, Elephantine, comes from back in the day when this was a very important centre point for the ivory trade, therefore elephant. It's also really important for the granite trade because of the quarry nearby, obviously. And yeah, that's where it comes from. And doesn't it offer a wonderful view of the East Bank? That's the church we were at earlier. The park we went to is up there. That's the fancy hotel that Agatha Christie stayed at. Not a bad little vista, is it? Elephantine Island would also have been the first place to know about any kind of changes in the level of the Nile and let everyone else know because they had a Nilometer. And there are a couple of like actual sites to visit on Elephantine Island, but I'm just here for the mooch at sunset, to be honest. It's a really peaceful little escape from cities and stuff. It's just nice and quiet. The Nilometer that I spoke about was actually made redundant by the Brits. There we are again, because we built the Aswan Dam, the infamous Aswan Dam in the early 1900s, built the low version. That broke. That was designed to stop the Nile flooding and stop everything getting wrecked every year. But then a bigger one was built, the High Aswan Dam, and that one was really controversial because although it worked brilliantly and did the job that the other one was supposed to do and did it really well, the problem was it cost $1 billion, so it's pretty pricey. It relocated a lot of people, for example the Nubians, thousands of them had to move where they lived. And well, this one I'm not sure is even a negative, but it removed all the crocodiles from the Nile in Egypt. It stopped any crocodiles getting further up. That does have ramifications with ecosystems and stuff like that, but no crocodiles. Seems like a good thing to me. And my dad was a bit concerned about the fact that I was going to get eaten by a crocodile on this trip. Well, so is dad, but there aren't any. At least not until I go south of Aswan tomorrow. Then I might get eaten by one. And we're back on the east bank of Aswan, and it brings us to the best sight of all. Got a KFC, boys. I'm off to go get me some food poisoning. See you tomorrow in a bit.